Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Shuang Li. This morning, I will introduce the DCP30 dataset, this set on Google Earth Engine. So this is part of our NEX summer school for the 2016. So this morning, this presentation will be three parts. First one, we will introduce the DCP30 dataset. And then we will give you a simple introduction with Google Earth Engine, this platform. At last, we will have a hands-on exercise. We will try to pull the data from this dataset and try to do some spatial analysis or time series analysis by using the DCP30 dataset. So, what's NEX DCP30? We all know that from yesterday, the DCP30 dataset is produced by NASA NEX team. It's a product from our National Climate Assessment Project. This dataset is so far it's the most high temporal resolution and spatial resolution dataset for our climate studies. This DCP30 covers the continental United States. It's a downscaled climate dataset, means it's generated from our GCM module, and we used different greenhouse gas emission scenarios. We used four different greenhouse gas emission scenarios. And we also used around 34 different models to generate this projection. This dataset was introduced to Google Earth Engine by last year. So in Google Earth Engine, we have the dataset from 1950 to 205. That's a historical data. We used to generate the dataset by using a retrospective run by using these models. And then we have projection dataset. It's from 2006 to 1999. In each dataset, there are three variables. We have precipitation, we have monthly maximum temperature, and minimum temperature. So the last one is there are different scenarios. We have RCP 26, 45, 60, 85. The RCP stands for Representative Concentration Pathway. It was defined by IPCC, the fifth assessment report. So here list all the scenarios and all the modules we were used in this production. In this tutorial, we will use RCP85 and the CCSM4. These two combination to use for our hands-on exercise. We will see it later. Okay, so here we have a figure to show how the dataset is stored on Google Earth Engine. The left panel is a image cube. I think everybody know the image cube, right? It's a two-dimension image, and then we have time series dataset stacked together. So for each image, you can see for here, for each variable, we can pull each variable out. We form a time series stack. So we can get the every location for the time series change. So understand how the dataset was saved on Google Earth Engine, it will better for us to use the dataset to conduct the spatial analysis or to how to get the correct answer. So next is Google Earth Engine. Google Earth Engine is a cloud-based platform. So far, everybody knows it's the most powerful cloud-based platform, right? But we have to know, there are three characters. So first one, it's performed highly interactive algorithm developed global scale. It's really, really amazing. You know, we used to have the other different cloud-based platform, but never one has this global scale dataset, including almost all the past 50 years or 40 years, we have the remote sensing dataset in global scale saved on this platform. We can use the data for any interesting research. Also, this platform give us a chance to access the big data. Access the big data and in the remote sensing, especially for the climate change. So, you know, for right now, we have a lot of observations from satellite, from airborne, from the other stations inside data set. But how to mix this data set together and to conduct our analysis, it's hard. Everybody knows our laptop, our desktop is limited with your computation resource, also with your storage resource. But this platform, you know, give us a chance to access this data set. Also, this platform enables high impact data-driven science, especially for the global climate science. You know, our climate science, we do not know during past many years, and we don't know after this century what the climate will change as, right? We have to use the data set to driven our research. So for this Google Earth Engine, we should know three things. It's very, very important for us to conduct any geospatial analysis on this platform. So first one, it's the deferred exactation. You have always to keep in mind that there is a client side, there is a server side. Always, for Google Earth Engine, they provide two client sides. One is the Python interface, one is the JavaScript. Usually, we will use the JavaScript so that we can use our web browser to conduct our research to generate quickly prompt code. But in this deferred exactation, that means all our analysis, it was not conducted immediately. It will be transferred to server side and then to transfer to server side objections. For example, you know, we have JavaScript, we have our object, right? But it's not a real object. We call it a proxy object. Every time when you submit your code to Google Earth Engine server side, they will transfer your code to JSON object. And then server side will run your code and then give back your result. So the next two things is related to our geospatial analysis. What skill and what's the projection? So the skill, it is related to our data, how the data was saved on Google Earth Engine and how to analysis the data. So the skill, we have this figure. This is from Google Earth Engine. All the data set, no matter you have one band or a few bands or more than 1,000 bands. So this is received in a skill. We also call it image pyramid mechanism to save the data. All the data set, for example, the raw data, there are 4 pixels, right? And then Google Earth Engine will save another by using this 4 pixel to average to 1 pixel. And then this 4 pixel, another 1 pixel to generate an image pyramid. So usually in our remote sensing or GIS field, we always use this for our data saving or for our data rendering, right? But for Google Earth Engine, it's different. For example, when you are using ArcGIS, right? You can pull your data to display on Google, on ArcGIS desktop. When you display this data, maybe using a different skew or the image pyramid for the display, only for the display. When you conduct any spatial analysis, you always use the raw pixels to conduct analysis. But Google Earth Engine, it's a pole-based, which means when you conduct a geospatial analysis on Google Earth Engine, you got to be very careful. Every time you conduct on your code, you need to define a skew. Which skew means which data will be pulled into the Google Earth Engine. So it will influence your output. Understand that, right? Means if you define different skew, the result will be different. It's hard to understand or to explain your result if you do not give a proper skew. Definitely, the higher skew make your analysis will quicker, faster, but it will, sometimes you may need the real data, real pixel values to calculate for your result. Okay. Next one is projection. The projection on our traditional GIS software, you know, for example, in our, the latest GIS software, they can conduct the projection or reprojection on the fly or dynamic projection, which means if you have a different projection dataset, you load into your platform, they will automatically to align each other, right? But when you conduct the analysis, you have to reproject the data together in the same projection, or you will get a wrong result. But on Google Earth Engine, it's different. You see here, Google Earth Engine, the projection is also a pole-based. This is a principle, which means no matter what the original dataset, the projection is, you do not need to care about that. You just need to define your output. Always depend on your output definition. You define the output definition, the projection, Google Earth Engine will automatically to load the data, reproject the data to your unit skew for different layers. They will reproject the same projection and then give you a map display and give you the spatial analysis. So it's compared to our traditional GIS software, it's easier. You do not need to always care about the projection issues. Next, and this is the last important principle we need to know. This is the Google Earth Engine. They defined a reducer. We always need a reducer to handle the dataset. For example, our DCP30 dataset on Google Earth Engine, there are tens of thousands of layers or bands. When you handle the dataset or you want to make some calculation, you need to select the proper layers or the proper data range. It always depends on this reducer. This is the Google Earth Engine introduction. And here we will have a heads-on